State and Revolution, Chapter 6, Vulgarization of Marx by the Opportunists. The question of the relation of the state to the social revolution, and of the social revolution to the state, like the question of revolution generally, occupied the best-known theoreticians and publicists of the Second International very little. But the most characteristic thing in that process of the gradual growth of opportunism, which led to the collapse of the Second International in 1914, is the circumstance that, even when those people actually came into contact with this question, they tried to evade it, or else failed to notice it. It may, in general, be said that the evasiveness on the question of the relation of the proletarian revolution to the state, an evasiveness which was convenient for opportunism and nourished it, resulted in a distortion of Marxism, and in its complete vulgarization. To characterize, if only in brief, this lamentable process, let us take the best-known theoreticians of Marxism, Plekhanov and Kautsky. Section 1. Plekhanov's Polemic Against the Anarchists. Plekhanov devoted a special pamphlet to the question of the relation of anarchism to socialism, entitled Anarchism and Socialism, published in German 1894. Plekhanov managed, somehow, to treat this topic without touching on the most vital, timely, and political essential point in the struggle with anarchism, the relation of the revolution to the state, and the question of the state in general. His pamphlet is divided into two parts, one historical and literary, containing valuable material for the history of the ideas of Stirner, Proudhon, and others. The second is philistine, and contains a clumsy dissertation on the theme that an anarchist cannot be distinguished from a bandit. An amusing combination of the subjects, and most characteristic of Plekhanov's whole activity on the eve of the revolution and during the revolutionary period in Russia. Indeed, in the years 1905 to 1917, Plekhanov showed himself to be half doctrinaire, half philistine, following politically in the wake of the bourgeoisie. We have now seen how Marx and Engels, in their polemics against the anarchist, explained most thoroughly their views on the relation of the revolution to the state. Engels, upon the publication of Marx's critique of the Gotha program in 1891, wrote that we, that is Marx and Engels, were then, hardly 2 years after the Hague Congress of the First International, in the fiercest phase of our struggle with Bakunin and his anarchists. The anarchists had tried to claim the Paris Commune as their own, as a confirmation of their teachings, thus showing that they had not in the least understood the lessons of the Commune, or the analysis of those lessons by Marx. Anarchism has failed to give anything even reproaching a true solution of the concrete political problems, such as, must the old state machinery be shattered, and what will be put in its place? But to speak of anarchism and socialism, leaving the whole question of the state out of account and taking no notice of the whole development of Marxism, either before or after the Commune, this meant an inevitable fall into opportunism. For that is just what opportunism wants, that the two questions just mentioned should not be raised at all. This is already a victory for opportunism. Section 2. Kautsky's Polemic Against the Opportunists. Undoubtedly, an immeasurably larger number of Kautsky's works have been translated into Russian than into any other language. It is not without justification that German social democrats sometimes say jokingly that Kautsky is more read in Russia than in Germany. We may say in parentheses that there is deeper historical significance in this joke than those who first made it suspected. For the Russian workers, having manifested in 1905 an extraordinarily strong and unprecedented demand for the best works of the social democratic literature in the world, and having been supplied with translations and editions of these works in quantities unheard of in other countries, thereby supplanted, so to speak, with an accelerated tempo, the immense experience of a neighboring, more advanced country to the almost virgin soil of our proletarian movement. Besides his popularization of Marxism, Kautsky is particularly well known in our country by his polemics against the opportunists, chiefly Bernstein. But one fact is almost unknown, which cannot be overlooked if we are to apply ourselves to the task of investigating how it was that Kautsky plunged into the unbelievably disgraceful morass of confusion and defense of social chauvinism at a time of the greatest crisis in 1914 and 1915. This fact is that shortly before he came out against the best-known representatives of opportunism in France and in Germany, Kautsky had shown very great vacillation. The Marxist journal, Zarya, which was published in Stuttgart in 1901 and 1902, and advocated revolutionary proletarian views, was forced to polemicize against Kautsky, to characterize as rubber-like his evasive, temporizing, and conciliatory attitude towards the opportunists, as expressed in his resolution at the International Socialist Congress in Paris in 1900. Letters have been published from Kautsky's pen in Germany, revealing no less hesitancy before he took the field against Bernstein. Of a measurably greater significance, however, is the circumstance that, in his very polemic against the opportunists, in his formulation of the question and his method of treating it, we can observe now that we are investigating the history of his latest betrayal of Marxism, his systematic gravitation towards opportunism, precisely on the question of the state. Let us take Kautsky's first big work against opportunism, Bernstein und das Sozialdemokratische Programm. Kautsky refutes Bernstein in detail, but the characteristic thing about it is the following. Bernstein accuses Marxism of blankism, an accusation since repeated thousands of times by the opportunist and liberal bourgeois in Russia against the representatives of revolutionary Marxism, the Bolsheviks. In this connection, Bernstein dwells particularly on Marx's The Civil War in France and tries, as we saw, quite unsuccessfully, to identify Marx's views of the lessons of the Commune with that of Proudhon. Bernstein pays particular attention to the Communist Manifesto to the effect that the working class cannot simply lay hold of the ready-made state machinery and wield it for its own purposes. The dictum pleased Bernstein so much that he repeated it no less than 3 times in his book, interpreting it in the most distorted opportunist sense. We have seen what Marx means, that the working class must shatter, break up, blow up, the whole state machinery. But according to Bernstein, it would appear as though Marx, by these words, warned the working class against excessive revolutionary zeal when seizing power. A crasser and uglier perversion of Marx's ideas cannot be imagined. How, then, did Kautsky act in his detailed refutation of Bernsteinism? He avoided analyzing the whole enormity of the perversion of Marxism by opportunism on this point. He cited the above-quoted passage from Engels' preface to Marx's Civil War, saying that, according to Marx, the working class cannot simply take possession of the ready-made state machinery, but, generally speaking, it can take possession of it, and that was all. As for the fact that Bernstein attributed to Marx the direct opposite of Marx's real views, that the real task of the proletarian revolution, as formulated by Marx ever since 1852, was to break up the state machinery, not a word of all this is to be found in Kautsky. The result was that the most essential difference between Marxism and opportunism on the question of the proletarian revolution was glossed over.
"The solution of the problem of the proletarian dictatorship," wrote Kautsky, supposedly in opposition to Bernstein, "we can safely leave to the future."
Page 172, German edition. This is not a polemic against Bernstein, but really a concession to him, a surrender to opportunism. For at present, the opportunists ask nothing better than to safely leave to the future all the fundamental questions on the task of the proletarian revolution. Marx and Engels, from 1852 to 1891, for 40 years, taught the proletariat that it must break up the state machinery. Kautsky, in 1899, confronted on this point with the complete betrayal of Marxism by the opportunists, fraudulently substitutes for the question as to whether it is necessary to break up the machinery, the question as to the concrete forms of breaking it up, and then saves himself behind the screen of the indisputable and barren Philistine truth that concrete forms cannot be known in advance. Between Marx and Kautsky, between their respective attitudes to the task of a proletarian party in preparing the working class for revolution, there is an abyss. Let us take the next, more mature work by Kautsky, also devoted, to a large extent, to a refutation of opportunist errors. This is his pamphlet, The Social Revolution. The author chose here as his special theme the question of the proletarian revolution and the proletarian regime. He gave here a great deal of valuable material, but evaded this question of the state. Throughout the pamphlet, the author speaks of the conquest of state power. and nothing else. That is, a formulation is chosen which makes a concession to the opportunist, since it admits the possibility of the conquest of power without the destruction of the state machinery. The very thing which Marx, in 1872, declared to be obsolete in the program of the Communist Manifesto, it is revived by Kautsky in 1902. In the pamphlet, a special section is devoted to the forms and weapons of the social revolution. Here he speaks of the political mass strike, of civil war, and of such instruments of force at the disposal of the modern large state as the bureaucracy and the army. But of that which the commune had already taught the workers, not a syllable. Evidently, Engels had issued no idle warning for the German social democrats particularly against superstitious reverence for the state. Kautsky profounds the matter in the following way. The victorious proletariat, he says, will realize the democratic program, and he formulates its clauses. But of that which the year 1871 taught us about bourgeois democracy being replaced by a proletarian one, not a syllable. Kautsky disposes of the question by such profound-looking banalities as,
"It is obvious that we shall not attain power under the present order of things. Revolution itself presupposes a prolonged and far-reaching struggle which, as it proceeds, will change our present political and social structure."
This is undoubtedly obvious, as much as that horses eat oats, or that the Volga flows into the Caspian Sea. It is only a pity that he should use this empty and bombastic phrase of far-reaching struggle to slur over the question essential for the revolutionary proletariat, namely, wherein exactly lies this far-reaching nature of its revolution with respect to the state, with respect to democracy, as distinguished from the non-proletarian revolutions of the past. By evading this question, Kautsky, in reality, makes a concession to opportunism in this most essential point, while declaring a terrible war against it in words, emphasizing the importance of the idea of revolution. How much is this idea worth if one is afraid to spread among the workers the concrete lessons of the revolution? Or declaring that revolutionary idealism is above all, that the English workers represent now little more than petty bourgeois?
"In a socialist society,"
Kautsky writes,
"there can exist side by side the most varied forms of economic enterprises, bureaucratic, trade union, cooperative, private. There are, for instance, such enterprises as cannot do without a bureaucratic organization. Such are the railways. Here, democratic organization might take the following form. The workers elect delegates who form something in the nature of a parliament, and this parliament determines the conditions of work and superintends the management of the bureaucratic apparatus. Other enterprises may be transferred to the labor unions, and still others may be organized on a cooperative basis."
This reasoning is erroneous and represents a step backward in comparison with what Marx and Engels explained in the 70s, using the lessons of the commune as an example. So far as this assumed necessity of bureaucratic organization is concerned, there is no difference whatever between railways and any other enterprise of large-scale machine industry, any factory, any large store, any large-scale capitalist agricultural enterprise. The technique of all such enterprises requires the very strictest discipline, the greatest accuracy in the carrying out by everyone of the work allotted to him, under peril of stoppage of the whole business or damage to the mechanism or product. In all such enterprises, the workers will, of course,
elect delegates who form something in the nature of a parliament.
But here is the crux of the matter. This something in the nature of a parliament will not be a parliament in the sense of bourgeois parliamentary institutions. The crux of the matter is that this something in the nature of a parliament will not merely determine the conditions of work and superintend the management of the bureaucratic apparatus, as imagined by Kautsky, whose ideas do not go beyond the framework of bourgeois parliamentarism. In socialist society, this something in the nature of a parliament, consisting of workers' deputies, will, of course, determine the conditions of work and superintend the management of the apparatus. But this apparatus will not be bureaucratic. The workers, having conquered political power, will break up the old bureaucratic apparatus. They will shatter it to its very foundations until not one stone is left upon another. And they will replace it with a new one consisting of these same workers and employees, against whose transformation into bureaucrats measures will at once be undertaken, as pointed out in detail by Marx and Engels. 1. Not only electiveness, but also instant recall. 2. Payment no higher than that of ordinary workers. 3. Immediate transition to a state of things when all fulfill the functions of control and superintendence, so that all become bureaucrats for a time, and no one, therefore, can become a bureaucrat. Kautsky has not reflected at all on Marx's words.
The commune was to be a working and not a parliamentary body, executive and legislative at the same time.
Kautsky has not in the least understood the difference between bourgeois parliamentarism, combining democracy not for the people with bureaucracy against the people, and proletarian democracy, which will take immediate steps to cut down bureaucracy at the roots, and which will be able to carry out these measures to their conclusion, to the complete destruction of bureaucracy and the final establishment of democracy for the people. Kautsky reveals here again the same superstitious reverence for the state and superstitious faith in bureaucracy. Let us pass to the last and best of Kautsky's works against the opportunists, his pamphlet, The Road to Power, which I believe has not been translated into Russian, for it came out during the severest period of reaction here in 1909. This pamphlet is a considerable step forward, inasmuch as it does not treat the revolutionary program in general, as in the pamphlet of 1899 against Bernstein, nor the tasks of the social revolution irrespective of the time of its occurrence, as in the pamphlet The Social Revolution, 1902, but the concrete conditions which compel us to recognize that the revolutionary era is approaching. The author definitely calls attention to the intensification of class antagonisms in general and to imperialism, which plays a particularly important part in this connection. After the revolutionary period of 1789 to 1871 in Western Europe, he says, an analogous period begins for the East in 1905. A world war is approaching with menacing rapidity. The proletariat can no longer talk of premature revolution. The revolutionary era is beginning. These declarations are perfectly clear. The pamphlet ought to serve as a measure of comparison between the high promise of German social democracy before the imperialist war and the depth of degradation to which it fell, Kautsky included, when the war broke out.
The present situation, Kautsky wrote in the pamphlet under consideration, contains this danger that we,
that is German social democracy,
may easily be considered more moderate than we are in reality.
In reality, the German Social Democratic Party turned out even more moderate and opportunist than it had seemed. The more characteristic it is that, side by side with such definite declarations regarding the revolutionary era that had already begun, Kautsky, in the pamphlet which, he says himself, is devoted precisely to an analysis of political revolution, again, completely dodges the question of the state. From all these evasions of the question, omissions and equivocations, there inevitably followed that complete surrender to opportunism of which we shall soon have to speak. German social democracy, in the person of Kautsky, seems to have declared, I uphold revolutionary views, 1889. I recognize, in particular, the inevitability of the social revolution of the proletariat, 1902. I recognize the approach of a new revolutionary era, 1909. Still, I disavow that which Marx said as early as 1852, if once the question is definitely raised as to the tasks confronting a proletarian revolution in relation to the state, 1912. It was precisely in this direct form that the question was put in the polemic of Kautsky against Pannekoek. Section 3. Kautsky's Polemic Against Pannekoek. Pannekoek came out against Kautsky as one of the representatives of the left radical movement, which counted in its ranks Rosa Luxemburg, Karl Radek, and others, and which, while upholding revolutionary tactics, was united in the conviction that Kautsky was taking a center position, that he was wavering in an unprincipled manner between Marxism and opportunism. The correctness of this view was fully proved by the war, when this center current, or Kautskyism, wrongly called Marxist, revealed itself in all its hideous squalor. In an article touching on the question of the state, entitled Mass Action and Revolution, Pannekoek characterized Kautsky's position as an attitude of passive radicalism, as a theory of inactive waiting. Kautsky does not want to see the process of revolution, says Pannekoek. In thus stating the problem, Pannekoek approached the subject which interests us, namely the tasks of a proletarian revolution in relation to the state.
The struggle of the proletariat,
he wrote,
is not merely a struggle against the bourgeoisie for the purpose of acquiring state power, but a struggle against the state power. The content of a proletarian revolution is the destruction of the instruments of the state power, and their forcing out, literally dissolution, by the instruments of the power of the proletariat. The struggle will not end until, as its final result, the entire state organization is destroyed. The organization of the majority demonstrates its superiority by destroying the organization of the ruling minority.
The formulation in which Pannekoek presented his ideas has very great defects, but its meaning is sufficiently clear, and it is interesting to note how Kautsky combated it.
Up till now,
he wrote,
the difference between social democrats and anarchists has consisted in this. The former wished to conquer state power, while the latter wished to destroy it. Pannekoek wants to do both.
If Pannekoek's exposition lacks precision and concreteness, not to speak of other defects which have no bearing on the present subject, Kautsky seized on just that one point in Pannekoek's article, which is the essential principle of the whole matter, and on this fundamental question of principle, Kautsky forsakes the Marxian position entirely and surrenders without reserve to the opportunists. His definition of the difference between social democrats and anarchists is absolutely wrong, and Marxism is thoroughly vulgarized and distorted. The difference between the Marxist and anarchist consists in this. 1. The Marxists, while aiming at the complete destruction of the state, recognize that this aim can only be realized after the abolition of classes by a socialist revolution, as the result of the establishment of socialism, leading to the withering away of the state. The anarchists want complete destruction of the state within 24 hours, not understanding the conditions under which such destruction can be carried out. 2. Marxists recognize that when once the proletariat has won political power, it must utterly break up the old state machinery and substitute it for a new one consisting of an organization of armed workers after the type of the commune. The anarchists, while advocating the destruction of the state machinery, have absolutely no clear idea as to what the proletariat will put in its place and how it will use its revolutionary power. The anarchists even reject the utilization by the revolutionary proletariat of state power, the revolutionary dictatorship of the proletariat. They reject. 3. The Marxists insist upon making use of the modern state as a means of preparing the workers for revolution. The anarchists reject this. In this controversy, it is Pannekoek, not Kautsky, who represents Marxism, for it was Marx who taught that it is not enough for the proletariat to simply conquer state power in the sense of the old state apparatus passing into new hands, but that the proletariat must break up, smash this apparatus, and replace it by a new one. Kautsky goes over from Marxism to the opportunists because, in his hands, this destruction of the state machinery, which is utterly unacceptable to the opportunists, completely disappears, and there remains for them a loophole in that they can interpret conquest as the simple gaining of a majority. To cover up his distortions of Marxism, Kautsky acts like the religious debater in the village. He advances quotations from Marx himself. Marx wrote in 1850 of the necessity of a decisive centralization of power in the hands of the state, and Kautsky triumphantly asks, does Pannekoek want to destroy centralism? This is nothing but sleight of hand, similar to Bernstein's identification of the views of Marxism and Proudhonism on federalism versus centralism. Kautsky's quotation is neither here nor there. The new state machinery admits centralism as much as the old. If the workers voluntarily unify their armed forces, this will be centralism. But it will be based on the complete destruction of the centralized state apparatus, the army, police, and the bureaucracy. Kautsky acts just like a swindler when he ignores the perfectly well-known arguments of Marx and Engels on the commune, and comes out with a quotation which has nothing to do with the case. He continues,
"Perhaps Pannekoek wants to abolish the state functions of the officials? But we cannot do without officials, even in our party and trade union organizations, much less in the state administration. Our program demands not abolition of state officials, but their election by the people. It is not a question as to the precise form which the administrative apparatus will take in the future state, but as to whether our political struggle destroys, literally dissolves, the state before we have conquered it. What ministry with its officials could be abolished?"
There follows an enumeration of the ministries of education, justice, finance, and war.
"No, not one of the present ministries will be removed by our political struggles against the government. I repeat, to avoid misunderstanding, it is not here a question of what form a victorious social democracy will give to the future state, but of how our opposition changes the present state."
This is an obvious trick. Revolution was the question Pannekoek raised. Both the title of his article and the passages quoted above show that clearly. When Kautsky jumps over to the question of opposition, he changes the revolutionary point of view for the opportunist. What he says is, opposition now, and a special talk about the matter after we have won power. And thus, the revolution has vanished, and that is precisely what the opportunist wanted. Opposition and general political struggle are beside the point. We are concerned with the revolution, and revolution consists in the proletariat's destroying the administrative apparatus and the whole state machinery, and replacing it by a new one consisting of the armed workers. Kautsky reveals a superstitious reverence for ministries, but why can they not be replaced, say, by commissions of specialists working under the sovereign, all-powerful Soviets of workers and soldiers' deputies? The essence of the matter is not at all whether the ministries will remain, or commissions of specialists or any other kind of institutions will exist. This is quite unimportant. The main thing is whether the old state machinery, connected by thousands of threads with the bourgeoisie and saturated through and through with routine and inertia, shall remain or be destroyed and replaced by a new one. A revolution must not consist in a new class ruling, governing with the help of the old state machinery, but in this class smashing this machinery and ruling, governing by means of new machinery. This fundamental idea of Marxism, Kautsky either slurs over or has not understood at all. His question about officials shows clearly that he does not understand the lessons of the commune or the teachings of Marx.
"We cannot do without officials even in our party and trade union organizations."
"We cannot do without officials under capitalism, under the rule of the bourgeoisie. The proletariat is oppressed. The laboring masses are enslaved by capitalism. Under capitalism, democracy is narrowed, crushed, curtailed, mutilated by all the conditions of wage slavery, the poverty and misery of the masses. This is the reason, and the only reason, why the officials of our political parties and trade unions become corrupt, or more precisely, tend to become corrupt under capitalist conditions, why they show a tendency to turn into bureaucrats, i.e., privileged positions detached from the masses and standing above the masses. That is the essence of bureaucracy, and until all the capitalists have been expropriated and the bourgeoisie overthrown, even proletarian officials will inevitably, to some extent, become bureaucratized. From what Kautsky says, one might think that if elective officials remain under socialism, bureaucrats and bureaucracy will also remain. This is entirely incorrect. Marx took the example of the commune to show that under socialism, the functionaries cease to be bureaucrats and officials. They change in the degree as election is supplemented by the right of instant recall, when, besides this, their pay is brought down to the level of the pay of the average worker, when, besides this, parliamentary institutions are replaced by working bodies, executive and legislative, at the same time. All Kautsky's arguments against Pannekoek, and particularly his splendid point that we cannot do without officials even in our parties and trade unions, show, in essence, that Kautsky is repeating the old arguments of Bernstein against Marxism in general. Bernstein's renegade book, Evolutionary Socialism, is an attack on primitive democracy. Doctrinaire democracy, as he calls it, imperative mandates, functionaries without pay, impotent central representative bodies, and so on. To prove that primitive democracy is worthless, Bernstein refers to the British trade union experience as interpreted by the Webbs. 70-odd years of development in absolute freedom have, he avers, convinced the trade unions that primitive democracy is useless, and led them to replace it with ordinary parliamentarism combined with bureaucracy. In reality, the trade unions developed not in absolute freedom, but in complete capitalist enslavement, under which one, naturally, cannot do without concessions to the prevailing evil, force, falsehood, exclusion of the poor from the affairs of the higher administration. Under socialism, much of the primitive democracy is inevitably revived, since, for the first time in the history of civilized society, the mass of the population rises to independent participation, not only voting and elections, but also in the everyday administration of affairs. Under socialism, all will take a turn in management, and will soon become accustomed to the idea of no managers at all. Marx's critico-analytical genius perceived in the practical measures of the commune that revolutionary turning point of which the opportunists are afraid, and which they do not want to recognize out of cowardice, out of reluctance to break irrevocably with the bourgeoisie, and which the anarchists do not want to perceive either through haste or a general lack of understanding of the conditions of great social mass transformations.
One must not even think of such a thing as destroying the old state machinery, for how shall we do without ministries and without officials?
Argues the opportunist, saturated through and through with Philistinism, and in reality not merely devoid of faith in revolution, in the creative power of revolution, but actually in mortal dread of it, like our Mensheviks and social revolutionaries.
One must think only of the destruction of the old state machinery, never mind searching for concrete lessons in earlier proletarian revolutions and analyzing with what and how to replace what has been destroyed.
Argues the anarchist, the best of the anarchists, of course, and not those who, with Messrs. Kropotkins and company, follow in the train of the bourgeoisie. Consequently, the tactics of the anarchist become the tactics of despair instead of a revolutionary grappling with concrete problems, ruthlessly courageous, and at the same time cognizant of the practical conditions under which the masses progress. Marx teaches us to avoid both kinds of error. He teaches us unswerving courage in destroying the entire old state machinery, and at the same time shows us how to put the situation concretely. The commune was able, within a few weeks, to start building a new proletarian state machinery by introducing such and such measures to secure a wider democracy and to uproot bureaucracy. Let us learn revolutionary courage from the communards. Let us see in their practical measures an outline of practically urgent and immediately possible measures, and then, following this road, we shall arrive at the complete destruction of bureaucracy. The possibility of such destruction is assured by the fact that socialism will shorten the working day, raise the masses to a new life, create such conditions for the majority of the population as to enable everybody, without exception, to perform state functions, and this will lead to a complete withering away of every state in general.
The object of a general strike,
Kautsky continues,
can never be to destroy the state, but only to wring concessions from the government on some particular question, or to replace a hostile government with one willing to meet the proletariat halfway. But never, under any conditions, can it, a proletarian victory over a hostile government, lead to the destruction of the state power. It can lead only to a certain shifting of forces within the state power. The aim of our political struggle, then, remains as before, the conquest of state power by means of gaining a majority in Parliament, and the conversion of Parliament into the master of the government.
This is nothing but the most clear and vulgar opportunism, a repudiation of revolution in deeds while accepting it in words. Kautsky's imagination goes no further than a government willing to meet the proletariat halfway. This is a step backwards to Philistinism, compared with 1849, when the Communist Manifesto proclaimed the organization of the proletariat as the ruling class. Kautsky will have to realize his beloved unity with the Scheidmans, Plekhanovs, and Vandervelds, all of whom will agree to fight for a government meeting the proletariat halfway. But we shall go forward to a break with these traitors to socialism, and we shall fight for complete destruction of the old state machinery in such a way that the armed proletariat itself is the government, which is a very different thing. Kautsky may enjoy the pleasant company of the legions, Davids, Plekhanovs, Shirnovs, etc., who are quite willing to work for the shifting of the relation of forces within the state, for gaining a majority in Parliament and the conversion of Parliament into the master of the government. A most worthy object, wholly acceptable to the opportunist, in which everything remains within the framework of a bourgeois parliamentary republic. We shall go forward to a break with the opportunists, and the whole of the class-conscious proletariat will be with us, not for a shifting of the relation of forces, but for the overthrow of the bourgeoisie, the destruction of bourgeois parliamentarism, for a democratic republic after the type of the commune, or a republic of Soviets of workers and soldiers' deputies, the revolutionary dictatorship of the proletariat. To the right of Kautsky, there are, in international socialism, such tendencies as the Socialist Monthly in Germany, the followers of Juarez and Vandervelde in France and Belgium, Tarati, Treves, and other representatives of the right wing of the Italian party, the Fabians and Independents, the Independent Labor Party, always dependent, as a matter of fact, on the liberals, in England, and the like. All these gentry, while playing a great, very often, predominant role in parliamentary work and in the journalism of the party, reject outright the dictatorship of the proletariat and carry out a policy of unconcealed opportunism. In the eyes of the gentry, the dictatorship of the proletariat contradicts democracy. There really is no essential difference between them and the petty bourgeois democrats. Taking these circumstances into consideration, we have a right to conclude that the Second International, in the persons of the overwhelming majority of its official representatives, has completely sunk into opportunism. The experience of the Commune has not only been forgotten, but distorted. Far from inculcating into the workers' minds the idea that the time is near when they are to rise up and smash the old state machinery and substitute it for a new one, thereby making their political domination the foundation for a socialist reconstruction of society, they have actually taught the workers the direct opposite of this, and represented the conquest of power in a way that left thousands of loopholes for opportunism. The distortion and hushing up of the question as to the relation of a proletarian revolution to the state could not fail to play an immense role at a time when the states, with their swollen military apparatus as a consequence of imperialist rivalry, had become monstrous military beasts devouring the lives of millions of people in order to decide whether England or Germany, this or that finance capital, should dominate the world.